What it takes to be a true devotee of the Lord. What it takes to cultivate love and devotion for God. What it means to completely surrender to God. We shall try to look into these spiritual aspects today in the light of life and teachings of Swami Premanandaji. One of the direct monastic disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. We all know Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa had 16 sannyasin monastic disciples. Swami Premanandaji is one among the 16. Also known as Babu Ram Maharaj. His pre-monastic name was Babu Ram Ghosh. Once he went to Malda, in a district headquarter town in West Bengal, upon an invitation to give talks there, he had chosen the topic service to man is service to God. You know, that is the philosophy Vivekananda also advocated. Serve the living gods, that's Vivekananda's philosophy. Serving the Lord through images, through portraits, okay. But there is a better way to worship the Lord, that is to worship Him through His living embodiments, that is through human beings, fellow human beings. But you must look upon them as emblems of the divine. You know, you won't be able to serve the people for long if you just see them as human beings. What happens if you see them as human beings, you find faults with them. Okay? That service will not give you much of joy. And you will find it very troublesome and painful. You will give that up afterwards. It is very difficult to sustain selfless service unless you learn to see every human being, for that matter, every living form, as an emblem of the divine. So Swami Premanandaji was talking about that because he could see the group of people who were in front of him, and then he understood that that would be the best teaching to be given to them. But there was a gentleman in the group. He asked Swami Premanandaji to speak on love and devotion. And in fact, Baburam Maharaj, Swami Premanandaji was talking about love and devotion for God only. For this age, you know, to please the Lord, to win the grace of the Lord, to have the blessings of the Lord, you must be able to love the people who are around you. They are not people, they are emblems of God only. If you can't serve these gods and you think you can please the Lord through an image only, and then you would be able to win His blessings and grace, it would not happen. You ill-treat the life around you. You misbehave with the life around you. You are irresponsible with the life around you. And then you go to a temple and do some ritual there, and you think God will shower His blessings upon you. It's not going to happen like that. Now, in our society, in our Swami Ranganathanji Maharaj, the 13th president of the Ramakrishna Order and our Puja Gurudev, used to say again and again, there is this dichotomy, we are very pious in the temple when you go to pilgrimage. But when it comes to behaving with our fellow human beings, we don't find God in them. We behave in an irresponsible manner. That is to be seen in the society. We are very pious in that way. We go to temples, we make pilgrimages. But when it comes to our conduct with our fellow human beings, do we behave in a responsible manner? Or do we hurt them very frequently? If you see them as emblems of the divine, your conduct will completely change. They will become objects of worship for you. Love will come out of you automatically. Reverence will come. Service will come. Shraddha will come. But we see them as actually kind of competitors or, you know, human beings. As soon as this human idea comes, you'll become more aware of the faults and shortcomings of people around us. Everybody has his or her own faults. We have our own faults that we forget. He is one type, I am one type. No, but I think I am the absolute. My type is the best type. So if I am the yardstick to judge the whole universe, then we'll see only faults and defects in others. Then it becomes very difficult to love others and to serve others, right? And not only that, we magnify those shortcomings or mistakes. It becomes a kind of habit. And even if it is a small mistake, a small fault with them, small shortcoming in them, they magnify to such an extent that you can't bear the person ultimately, you can't get along the individual. This guy is no good, totally no good. We come to that conclusion and find it difficult to work with them or to be with them. That's the reason why there is so much of peacelessness in homes, in workplaces. So it is in the human nature, the nature of the human mind is such, it becomes more conscious of the shortcomings and faults of others. That's why it's very important whenever you see a human being, what are the good qualities in that particular person? Okay, I can learn something from everybody. This individual has something good in him or her. Let me learn what good actually I can take from him or her. You look at actually with that kind of eye, you will find something very beautiful in that individual, which you don't have probably. And if it becomes a second nature, cultivate this habit, afterward the whole world will get transformed for you. Every object will become, every individual will become worthy of your worship, because every individual has got some beauty with him or her. But as we don't pay much attention to our mind and the nature of the mind, how it works, how it looks upon people, we don't work upon ourselves, we think it's okay to find faults with others, to look upon the shortcomings of others. Everybody does that, I also do the same thing. No, mind cheats us, deceives us, and makes us peaceless. This is the reason why actually, you know, peacelessness comes into societies and individuals. So Baburam Maharaj, Swami Premanandaji, he asked the group of people in front of him to serve their fellow human beings. That is the best worship that you can do for the Lord. But they were not convinced. One gentleman was not convinced. He was asking him again, you speak something about love and devotion, love and devotion. Again and again he insisted. Then Baburam Maharaj said, there is nobody who can understand, you know, love and devotion in the group present before me, he said. And then he said a small story. There was a hawker who would sell love. One day he was in the streets shouting, love for sale, love for sale. So all the people opened their doors, and what is the price? And he said, price is your head. If you give her your head, I will give the love for you. So this is the price that you need to pay if you really want love, love for God. Then everybody closed their doors, slammed their doors and went inside. So what it means to cultivate love and devotion for God, what it means to completely surrender to the Divine. We shall learn these things from some of the incidents that have happened in Swami Premananji Maharaj's life. You know, he did not pass VA exam. He went to Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna could see that a very pure soul, you know. Sri Ramakrishna said, he is pure up to his bone marrow. He is pure to the core. Swami Brahmananji also said the same thing. Sri Ramakrishna certified means the ultimate certificate. The judgment was unerring. So, but you know, when we are in the world, we have responsibilities towards the family and towards friends. You have to pass the exam. Sri Ramakrishna never cared for the secular education. So he was trying to saddle between the two. That is, to focus on his studies. Swami Premananji, Babu Ramaraj, he doesn't want to disappoint his mother and parents, because and also he wants to pursue the spiritual path. He was coming to Sri Ramakrishna, and one day Sri Ramakrishna told Master Mahasai, the recorder of the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, you see, this Baburam wants to manage both this and that. You know, you can't have God in part. You know, trying to have God partially is no good, he said. So why can't you give that up? What is important? So anyway, he couldn't focus much on his studies. He failed the exam. Then Master Mahasai told Sri Ramakrishna, Baburam Maharaj, he couldn't pass his BA exam, he failed in the exam. And Sri Ramakrishna said, very good, very good. So now you have failed to pass, then you will go beyond all passes, he said. Then Bengali pass means, you know, the meaning is, in Bengali pass means fetters, chains. So you will go beyond all passes, means you will go beyond all fetters, all chains. You will go beyond samsara itself. Don't worry about this examination. A blessing in disguise. Sri Ramakrishna never paid any, you know, attention to these studies, secular studies. But if somebody has purity, somebody has that seed of dispassion, he would be immensely pleased with the individual. Okay? A little devotion for God, that seed of vairagya, dispassion. Then he would encourage them actually to pursue the spiritual path with heart and soul. Because the probability of them, you know, attaining self-realization, very high. So that's what he meant when he said that Babu Rao Maharaj is very pure. There's no taint of worldliness in him. The desire for worldly objects, the desire for worldly pleasures are not there with him. And that's the reason actually Sri Ramakrishna used to love him a lot. And so, he said, okay, afterwards he was in his training, he attained a lot of spiritual sadhana he did under the guidance of Sri Ramakrishna himself. When he went to Sri Ramakrishna first day, I think along with Swami Brahmananji and one more, Ram Dayal Babu, three of them were there with Sri Ramakrishna that night. So up to 10 o'clock they had talked and conversed on many spiritual matters. Afterwards they went for sleep. At 11 o'clock, after about an hour, Sri Ramakrishna came out of his room and with dhoti in his armpit. And he was asking them, actually, says Ram Dayal Babu and Swami Premananji, who was sleeping in the veranda in the Dakshineshwar, next to Sri Ramakrishna's room. So you see, Naren has not come to here for a very long period. I feel as if somebody was wringing my soul. He would feel as if actually he was wringing his soul with it, like a wet cloth, how we wring, like that. He would feel separation so intensely, particularly for Naren. He has not come for many days. Please, somebody can go and tell him to come to this place to see me. Then they consoled him and then again he went back and sleep. After 1 hour, again he would come out, again he would talk about Naren. That was his first experience with Sri Ramakrishna. Of course, afterwards, you know, he was made up of pure sattva, Sri Ramakrishna said. That's why he is Narayana himself, he would say about Naren, future Swami, Vivekananda. So, Babu Rao Maharaj, he practiced a lot of sadhana under the guidance of Sri Ramakrishna. And he had served him a lot when Sri Ramakrishna was in Kashipur. He had cancer. And one of the few monastic disciples who were Babu Rao Maharaj was one of the few direct disciples who was with him till the end. Because he had taken permission from his mother Matangini Devi. So I would serve, I would stay at Dakshineshwar, and then later on when Sri Ramakrishna came to Kashipur, he also came there. And also Holy Mother Sri Sarada Devi would feel comfortable with Swami Premananji Maharaj. He had received her blessings also in abundance. So after Sri Ramakrishna's passing away, you know, all these disciples had practiced a lot of sadhana. That Bharanagar Mutt, later they came to Belur Mutt. And they had undertaken a lot of pilgrimages also, different disciples, at different times according to their convenience. Then Swamiji established this Sri Ramakrishna order in 1897. Swamiji passed away in 1902. And the responsibility of conducting the affairs of the mission fell on other disciples like Swami Brahmananji, Swami Shivananji, Swami Premananji, Babu Rao Maharaj. Swami Brahmananji Maharaj was staying in Kashi, had gone there, and he was not coming back to Belur Mutt. And Swami Premananji wanted to bring him back to Belur Mutt. And he went there and he told to Swami Brahmananji Maharaj, Maharaj, you have to come to Belur Mutt. That is the place of Swamiji. He is our Shiva. He established it. So you must come to Belur Mutt. Because Swami made him the president of the order. President of the order must stay in Belluru, Calcutta. But Swami Brahmanji did not reply. He was happy to stay in Kashi, the Shiva's place, Vishwanath's place. Afterwards, he went to Allahabad. And Swami Premananji also accompanied Swami Brahmananji. Brahmanji didn't reply. He asked him, requested him, you come to Belluru Math. So one day, he went and prostrated before him, and he was not getting up. And Swami Brahmanji said, get up, Baburam, get up, what are you doing? So he said, no, I will not get up unless you promise that you would come to Belluru Math. You know, then Brahmanji said, okay, I will come. Then he got up. So this is what self-surrender is. You know, when Brahmananji said that, you know, he didn't say, I won't come, but he didn't reply. Both were actually disciples of same Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. So he could have gone back, but how to make him, you know, agree to come? He surrendered, total surrender, absolute surrender. So Brahmananji Maharaj, of course, he was the Manasaputra, mind-born son of Sri Ramakrishna. But the kind of surrender you just see, he prostrated before him and didn't get up. That was how actually he convinced him, the surrender. Because Swami Brahmananji Maharaj was not an ordinary soul for him. He was just the emblem of Sri Ramakrishna himself. The respect that he would give to Sri Ramakrishna, he had given to Sri Brahmananji also. And then he yielded. So what goes on in the minds of such people, it would be difficult for us to know. But as a topic today is the price of devotion. Somebody who has completely surrendered to God, you would have no objection to surrender before any form of God. Every being is a form of God, much less a person like Swami Brahmananji, a spiritually elevated soul, a realized soul. Forget about making prostration before Swami Brahmananji. What is great in that? Swami Brahmananji is an elevated soul, you might say. Once when he was in Belluru Math, he was the manager of Belluru Math. A devotee went there from Chennai. So he went and he got tired, and one afternoon, no, in the night time, actually he was just sleeping in the veranda. And Swami Premananji got up. How he used to serve the devotees? He got up midnight and he saw the devotee sleeping in the veranda without any mosquito curtain. You know, Belluru Math on the bank of the Ganges. Very difficult to sleep without a mosquito curtain. At dead of the night, Swami Premananji arranged a mosquito curtain without disturbing him and started fanning him. And the devotee got up and he was stunned to see, overwhelmed, to see Maharaj doing all this service to him. And Swami Premananji said, it's okay, just rest comfortably. Because he was not serving just a devotee, for him actually an emblem of the divine. You know, that is the kind of surrender you need to display if you really want to love God. Not only that. So one day a group of devotees went to Belluru Math and they went to the shrine, leaving their chappals and shoes in the courtyard. Suddenly rain started. There was a brahmachari. So what he was doing, he was putting the shoes and chappal in the veranda. How he was doing? He was using his foot, you know, to carry the shoes of the devotees. Then Baburam Maharaj, Swami Premananji, saw this and he said, you must carry this chappal and shoes on your head. You must carry, he was telling brahmachari. Probably he might have thought that this brahmachari has the feeling that I am brahmachari, I am practicing self-control, I am a monk, so I am superior to others, these devotees are householders. So to teach a lesson to him, as it were, he told him that you must carry the shoes on your head. That is the degree of self-effacement, the self-abnegation that is insisted. This is low, this is high. Everybody is a form of God, then how is that actually? Before some people, you bow before and you show highest reverence and these people you think are inferior to you, when you have that idea that somebody is superior, somebody is inferior, or you consider yourself superior because you are in a station of life, you are a sannyasi, you are a brahmachari, okay, I am in a better station of life, a higher station of life, this is all vanity. It will not help you experience God. In fact, you need to serve the so-called inferior, so-called lowest, so-called underprivileged. Then actually there's a better way to, you know, get rid of the ego sense than to serve somebody who is pure or somebody who is high, somebody who is well-educated, somebody who is better placed or highly placed in the society. Everybody would respect such people, right? But somebody who is a kind of nobody or a commoner, if you serve that individual with greatest humility and looking God in him, then it becomes easy for you to get rid of your ego sense and come closer to God. And that's why Babu Ramana is told, you have to carry the ship on your head, not with your foot. He could see that there is a sense of superiority in brahmachari. There was an incident. You know, in those days, many revolutionaries joined the Ramakrishna mission. In the beginning, they participated in the freedom movement. They were revolutionaries. Police filed cases against them. Afterwards, they were fed up with this politics and they came to mission and joined. But the police would not leave them, right? We don't know. Probably they are carrying their activities from the monastery, the safe place nobody would go and see. But the British would not leave like that. They would actually engage spies. Police would come in plain clothes to Belur Mutt and watch over the people who had joined. Earlier were revolutionists and joined now in the monastery. Whether they are just doing their spiritual sadhana or indulging in political activities from Belur Mutt. So they would go frequently. Our General Secretary Maharaj, the General Secretary Maharaj, Saradananji, had to face a lot of humiliation many a time in the hands of these police and Britishers. But he would bear all that, you know, great sense of joy, because they would see, because they were all direct disciples, they are all enlightened souls, spiritual souls, whether the transformation was genuine or not. If the individual is still strongly interested in politics, they would dissuade them, this is not the place, you go back better. But if you're really interested in spiritual life, you're fed up with the politics, okay, then you pursue the spiritual sadhana. It doesn't matter what background you come from. It doesn't matter. Previously you were involved in politics, but you're welcome. One day, a plainclothes policeman went there. In the afternoon, it was a hot summer. He went there on foot. Then he sat on a bench there. So Swami Prema, from his window room, this man came in the afternoon, hot sun, perspiring, totally exhausted. He went there on foot. Because his superiors instructed him, his boss, you go and actually see. Sorry, then Maharaj saw him, he was perspiring, so he went there. He had given him prasad, he had given him some cold water, and he started fanning him. The policeman was surprised. So he knew that, Swami Premananda knew that he was a policeman in plain clothes. In spite of knowing him, that he was a policeman, spy, came just to see, you know, on spying activity he came. But that did not prevent him actually from serving him. Just came in a hot sun, a fellow human being, suffering, that's all. Without any trace of ill will towards him, you just see unconditional law. If somebody is useful to us, somebody is very close to us, our relative, he works against your interest. But to serve such an individual with that kind of love and affection is not easy. That is the price of devotion, in fact. If you really love God, you won't make any distinction. After all, he is doing his duty, poor man. He came in the afternoon, hot sun, suffering. Afflicted individual, that's all. Why did he show that much of consideration? He is an afflicted individual, hot sun, maybe, you know, thirsty. He went and just served him. One day, Swami Vivekananda, when he was in Belur Mutt, went to the temple. And Swami Premananji was worshipping Sri Ramakrishna with flowers and sandal paste. You know, normal, regular worship that is done to Sri Ramakrishna, he was doing. And Swamiji looked at him and told, Baburam, you have been worshipping, you know, the Lord, through flowers and sandal paste, it's all good, it's okay, fine. But you worship the Lord by serving the afflicted. So go to Belur village and serve some afflicted people. Swami gave an instruction. Baburam Maharaj didn't say that, why should I do that actually? No, I am fond of this kind of worship. I worship God only in this way. Upon the instruction of Swamiji, he went to Belur village and there he found one old widow. And he wanted to give some medical assistance to her through Belur Math dispensary. Of course, she didn't take from him. Then he found few children who were not well clothed, who were not well fed, children of poor people. He brought all those children to Belur Math. He gave them good bath. He gave them nice clothes. And then he fed them well. And then he put them back in their village. And he told Swamiji that day that I felt as if I was worshipping Sri Ramakrishna through these living gods. He made no distinction between worshipping Sri Ramakrishna through the portrait and worshipping Sri Ramakrishna through his living embodiments. For most of us, if you look at it, in temple it's easy for us to worship the Lord, and to worship the Lord through human beings, his living forms, this is very difficult. And Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda put Swami Premananji Maharaj to a kind of test as it were. So he understand only this kind of worship, or he can worship actually the Lord through his living embodiments with the same ease with which he is worshipping the Lord through this portrait. And first, Premananji Maharaj, absolutely no distinction. I'm comfortable with this kind of worship, worshipping the Lord through the portrait, and I'm also equally comfortable worshipping the Lord through the living images. He did it. And Swamiji must have been immensely pleased at this. And Vivekananda was particularly fond of this kind of worship. He insisted so much on this, particularly for this age. And even for meditation, even if people want to meditate, if you are an intensely selfish and self-centered individual, it will be very difficult for you to meditate. Your mind will not just rest like that. And that is the reason selfless service actually is a kind of prerequisite, the kind of preliminary requirement for you actually to be able to meditate well. So in fact, Vivekananda asked to combine all the four yogas. You serve, selfless service is as good as meditation, if it is done in right spirit. It is as good as meditation. The Bhagavad Gita also, Lord Krishna insisted on detached action. So these are all spiritual sadhanas only, but we have a lot of conditioning of mind. This is only the spiritual sadhana. This is social service. Other thing is social service. You know, as many people say that Ramakrishna Mission is a social service organization. Time and again we keep telling them, actually ours is not a social service organization. It's a spiritual organization. The other day, one of our Swami came from one of our center. There actually they are serving the tribals. And Swami had a little displeasure that our objectives are not being met, not being served well. I asked why. We wanted to give some spiritual teaching, some spirituality to the people, but they don't receive it as much as we expected. And then we had a kind of conversation, you know. They, all these days, they used to live in forests. Just now, actually, they are seeing the world. They are running a huge, big hostel there. They are being fed nicely. You know, they have just come from the forest. They have never seen this world. They have never seen this kind of life. They have never experienced any kind of joy, any kind of luxury. And how do you expect them to receive the spiritual instructions? It's too early, right? Let them have a little enjoyment of the world. Then they will understand. And afterwards, they will be able to receive the spiritual teachings. And then he said, yes, our head of the center also says the same thing. Practically, there the situation is kind of this. These are all spiritual seekers, monks, you know, they read Vivekananda, they read, you know, scriptures and came here for spiritual illumination. And whom they are serving? They're serving the people who are actually in an evolutionary sense, if you speak about. Very simple, very guileless, very emblem of the divine, they are all. But they have not had much of bhoga, much of enjoyment. Renunciation doesn't come just like that. But you just see the paradoxical situation. God is making the so-called highly evolved people, spiritual seekers, saw the people who are lowest in terms of, you know, spiritual evolution. Very pure and guileless there are. But we get education, you know, we all consider them, they are, you know, not developed people, no? That's why so much of, you know, development actually we try to do there. We want to bring them mainstream. What happens? Now they are peaceful there, but that peace is not real peace. It's a tamasic peace. We bring them into the mainstream, then we disturb their peace. They will have their secular education. Their desires get multiplied. Okay, their peace will get disturbed. And then they will long for peace. And then they also need spirituality. And then they come. There is a full circle. There is a full circle. So their peace will be disturbed. As of now, they are perfectly fine in the forest. They are quite well. But they have not seen life in its entirety. So we bring them into the mainstream. So what happens when you give them secular education? They also want all the material things that we, you know, possess or that we want. That means their desires get multiplied. Then automatically peacelessness will start. So they try to satisfy their desire, they struggle for more money and more wealth. There will always be a mismatch, there will always be a gap. Okay, whatever you want, you don't get it. Then frustration, disappointment, peacelessness. And then the peacelessness actually will bring you to spirituality and scriptures. And now you talk about spiritual things, the relish. So those who have not had even the little of enjoyment from this world, they cannot. So the head of the center told, you know, just now they have taken the human embodiment. It takes some time for me to understand and appreciate these teachings. So we shouldn't be expecting that much from them. One day, Swami Premananji Maharaj was giving instruction to the monks. He was telling them, you must set your life as an example for others to emulate and follow. You are men now, you must become gods. But through spiritual sadhana, you must become gods. That means you must enshrine God. Through spiritual sadhana, you would be able to do that. Great responsibilities will devolve upon you afterwards. Many will come seeking spiritual guidance from you. Multitudes will come in future. I could see the future. So Premananji Maharaj was telling them. Then the monk said, Maharaj, who will listen to us? Why? He said, why won't they listen? They will come seeking the spiritual food. So make yourself ready to give them the spiritual instruction, and that instruction will happen not just by reading scriptures. And Swami Premananji Maharaj was telling them, through your life, you must do such sadhana, you must conduct yourself in such a way that you would set your life as an example for them to follow you. And then the monk didn't get convinced of it, he said, so we are all, you know, not that great. Sri Ramakrishna made you great. And then Swami Premananji told, not. See, we have seen Sri Ramakrishna in flesh and blood. We had tasted his unconditional love, how much he used to love. And many of these monastic disciples felt that their parents also did not love them as intensely as Sri Ramakrishna loved them. They could feel tangibly. They tasted that love. Unconditional love. So we had seen him, we tasted his love, and we have renounced the world. Much easier, right? So ours is not a big achievement, a great thing. That this monk has come reading Sri Ramakrishna, because he didn't see Sri Ramakrishna, because Sri Ramakrishna passed away in 1886 itself. You have come without seeing Sri Ramakrishna. You have read Sri Ramakrishna and you have come here. So the greater blessings of Sri Ramakrishna are upon you. You are still great, he said. And then the monk said, Sri Ramakrishna himself made you great. And then Babu Ram Maharaj told, no, no, no. He has not made us great. He has made us nobodies. We are non-entities. In fact, we are also need to become non-entities. Not that you are something, I am great. People might say that you are great, but don't lap it up. It's Maya. Say, I am a non-entity, I am a nobody. That is the price of devotion. Don't try to become something. We are always struggling in the world to become something and something. That something will never end. That something will forever remain something. Become nothing, then you become everything. This nothing and everything are very close to each other, one and the same. But if you want to become something, it's a never-ending exercise. Everybody has a sense of, you know, lack. I lack this, I don't have this, I don't have that. Let me make myself full, you know, by achieving this. Let me compensate for this lack, let me compensate for this absence. This is how the struggle starts in the world. We will never be able to complete yourself like that. As mind and as body, we are never complete. And whatever may be the possessions that you bring from this world, that will never give you the sense of fulfillment that you are really seeking. You are already complete, you are already full. Only this ego sense makes us, this desire makes us unfulfilled. Drop that. You are complete. You are soul, you are spirit, you are infinite. You are consciousness. That is the glory of every one of us. And so, Premananda is told that we are all non-entities. Become a non-entity. Don't have the vanity that you are something. That I am a brahmachari, I am a monk. This also creates sometimes vanity. So Sri Ramakrishna made us non-entities. We are nobodies. So all the problem is because of the ego sense only. They drop this and become a non-entity. I am nothing, you say. O Lord, thou art. Not I, but thou. All our suffering has only one reason, I. Is it not? Right? Whenever we have an occasion, you know, to suffer something in the world, everybody should do this. What he or she should do is, what is the source of pain? When you look inside, pain is not happening from outside. But 99% of the people today are in still that mode of thinking that this guy is responsible, the situation is responsible, circumstances are not good. The tendency is to look for an external agent for our suffering. There is no external agent for anybody's suffering for that matter. The agent is within, that is the mind. The things around, the circumstances around, the people around, they behave the way they want to behave. What is that to you? From where the suffering is coming? Have you asked for something, you have not got it? Oh, I feel pain. From where? From within. And what is the source of pain? Mind. Then the next question should arise in your mind. In you. And what is mind? If this is the source of pain, let me find out the truth about the mind. What is the mind? You turn inward. Oh, it is based on ego sense. You drop that ego sense and see what happens. Absolute joy. Bliss. That cannot be explained in words. Will become your own. Now we want to fix the external world. That is the mistake we do. Birth after birth, we keep doing this. After many births, we understand. It is the mind actually which is playing mischief. The thief is not outside, within. And then the question arises, what is mind? You look inward, turn inward, and then you see, find ego sense. This eye is responsible for all that. Then you want to know the mystery of that eye. Then you will understand that it is fictitious, it is unreal. It's not there, in fact. You go deep into it, you will find that it is a non-existent thing. It's just a spurious projection. And drop that. I'm not asking you something real in you to drop that, to part with that, to give away that. Something spurious, something unreal. Okay? Something mischievous. What is the trouble, you know, to drop that? So not I. We have discussed here many a time that the whole universe belongs to God. So when the whole universe belongs to Him, this also belongs to Him. You are just an instrument in His hands. Right? Sri Ramakrishna used to give the example. You know, nowadays that those sights we don't see, earlier days, these monkey catchers, they catch monkeys. The 4-5 monkeys will be there. The monkey man, what he does? He will tie all these monkeys to the hands. Okay, then one single rope will be there, and with us, multiple ropes. With that, he will tie their necks. And whenever the monkey, you know, plays mischief, it becomes too restless, you just pull that. So you are under my control to tell that. You can't do whatever you want to do here. Or like that, we are all tied to that divine will, the only will that acts through every particle in this universe. And all things happen only according to that will. If you understand this and drop this little puny individuality, little, okay, sense of agency that we have, you are a blessed soul. So to drop this, nature hints at us. You have not dropped it, it is saying, whenever we have an occasion to feel some trouble, whenever we have an occasion to experience some kind of pain, then nature is telling that the pain is coming from this ego sense, from this individuality, from this limited little individualized will. Drop that, this is the source of pain. Nature actually wants to give us a lesson. It is actually hinting at that all the time. But we don't learn that fast. And we think, I don't have money, that's why I'm suffering. Other individuals, my relatives are not behaving, my family members actually are not cooperating with me. These are the complaints that we have, right? My boss actually is not a good guy. He treats me. The number of, you know, excuses we have. And we think that pain comes from outside. It doesn't come from outside, it comes from within. It comes from the mind. So, this sense of agency must be dropped. The sooner you understand that, the better for you. It's all choice. God gives us a choice. When you want to learn your lesson. How soon you want to learn your lesson. If you are a smart individual, you will learn your lesson very fast. If you are a dullard, it will take more time. So Swami Premananji Maharaj, one day what happened? Swamiji was in Belur Math. You know, Swamiji had one disciple, Sarath Chandra Chakravarti. If you read talks with Vivekananda, you will come across a good many questions, wonderful questions Sarath Chandra Chakravarti had asked Vivekananda, and Swamiji had given beautiful answers to those questions. Talks with Vivekananda, you will get that. So that Sarath Chandra Chakravarti had a dream. In that dream, he was worshipping Swamiji. And then he came to Swamiji and told about his dream and requested him to permit him to worship him. At Swamiji had to agree, he acquiesced, okay. Then Sarath Chandra Chakravarti worshipped him. But the tray he had used was the tray that would be used for Sri Ramakrishna's worship. And Swamiji knew before that only, but he didn't stop him from worship. You know, he did not stop Sarath Chandra Chakravarti not to use the tray. He had taken the worship, and afterwards then he told Sarath Chandra, you see, what you have done, what a sacrilegious act you have performed. This tray is used to collect flowers and to worship Sri Ramakrishna, and using that tray, putting my feet in that tray, you worshipped me, and use the flowers from this tray. And now if Swami Premananji sees, he will be in a rage. How dare you do that? And then when Swamiji uttered these words, that time only Premananji arrived. And then Swamiji told Baburam, you see what this Sarath has done. He has worshipped my feet in the tray that is used for Sri Ramakrishna's worship, to collect flowers for Sri Ramakrishna's worship. What a sacrilege he has done, you just see. And you know the reaction of Swami Premananji said, are you and Master are different? Are you and Master different? You see, now it is not difficult for us to understand that Sri Ramakrishna and Vivekananda are not two different entities. And Swami Vivekananda himself said that, you know, Sri Ramakrishna has transmitted all his power on his deathbed when he was last days. And Sri Ramakrishna himself said, now I became a pauper. All the power and energy he has spiritual power, he has transmitted to, you know, Vivekananda. And Swami just said that what he used to call as Mother Kali entered into you know, this body, and she is making me do all what I am doing. So now it is easy for us to understand, they are not there physically in front of us, that Sri Ramakrishna and Vivekananda are obverse and reverse of the same coin, they are both sides of the same coin. But that time, when Swami Vivekananda was a monastic disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, and Swami Premananji also was a monastic disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, they were contemporaries, and both actually went to Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna was their guru. And he could have told him, how did you allow to worship your feet with a tray used to worship our guru, Sri Ramakrishna? To recognize that Swami Vivekananda and Sri Ramakrishna were one and the same. When Swamiji was alive, it was not a small thing and simple thing. And Swami Premananji, he knew who Swami Vivekananda was, and so he never said, opposed Vivekananda, and whatever he would say, he would implement. He would put it into practice immediately. He never said no to Vivekananda. He had that regard for him. For him, Swami Vivekananda was none other than Sri Ramakrishna. That's what I'm saying. You know, to understand that Vivekananda was Sri Ramakrishna himself was not an easy thing. Very few direct disciples had understood that. Very few household disciples had understood that. I said, no difference between you and Sri Ramakrishna. He did the right things. What Sarat Chandra Chakravarti did the right thing. Nothing sacrilegious he has done. And also one day, in what esteem Swami Premananji held Master Mahasai, the recorder of Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. One day this Mahendranath Gupta, also known as Master Mahasai, went to Belur Mutt. He carried a little puffed rice with him, and he was sitting in the courtyard, and he wanted to eat that puffed rice. He was inquiring with a monk whether he would get some curds. And the monk went inside the storeroom. He saw there was a pot of curd, but it has not been offered to Sri Ramakrishna. Then he was in dilemma how to give this curd which has not been offered. That's actually meant for offering to Sri Ramakrishna. Then he was coming back in the veranda. Then Baburam Maharaj encountered him. What is the matter? He asked. So here is Master Mahasai. He wanted some curds, but this is there, but has not been offered to Sri Ramakrishna. Then immediately Swami Premananji took that pot and went to the portrait of Sri Ramakrishna, held it before him, and closed his eyes and prayed to him. And then gave it to the monk. He gave it to Mahendranath Guptaji, Master Mahasai. And afterwards he told, actually, today's master prevented me from a mistake. You think actually Master Mahasai, for Sri Ramakrishna's incarnation, he is the Vyasa. He is the Vyasa of this age. You know, you just read Sri Ramakrishna's gospel, it's like kind of encyclopedia on spirituality, if you ask me. Bhagavad Gita is not easy to understand, purely philosophical text. Upanishads also very subtle and abstract teachings. But Sri Ramakrishna, a god of parables, simple parables, anecdotes, you know, daily incidents that happen in our lives, through that very abstract Vedantic truth, how beautifully he narrates. Even a common man can understand what is the highest Vedanta philosophy. That is the beauty of that book. We got it because of Master Mahasai, this Mahendranath Gupta. So whenever he would go to Dakshineshwar, he would hear the conversation between Sri Ramakrishna and the group of disciples, devotees that would assemble there. And after coming back home, he would write in a diary. Without fail, the same thing he would actually visualize in front of his mind eye, and then he would jot down everything. And afterwards he compiled it into a book form. If you read the gospel now, you would be transported to Dakshineshwar. You would be taken to the presence of Sri Ramakrishna. That much of potency is there in the book. Everybody experiences that. And so Baburam Maharaj knew the greatness of Master Mahasai. And he said to that monk, Sri Ramakrishna himself eats through these devotees. They served Sri Ramakrishna, they saw Sri Ramakrishna, they came in the company of Sri Ramakrishna. I don't think they are ordinary human beings. Sri Ramakrishna himself eats with these devotees, and feeding them is like feeding 1,000 monks, he said. And that was the kind of reverence that he had held Master Mahasaya. And he said, it's not only the Vyasa, he's the Narada of this age. And really, we all need to be, you know, grateful to Master Mahasaya for his wonderful contribution. That's Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. Any doubt, any spiritual doubt, whatever the doubt you may have, you just go to that book and read it. Your doubt will become clear. And that's why I say it's an encyclopedia and for spiritual sadhakas, and also the teachings of these direct disciples. You also can read this book, God Lived With Them, written by Swami Chaitanyananji. You come across the lives of all these direct disciples. Some of the teaching that you don't get in Gospel, because Gospel are the conversations, mostly the conversations happen between Sri Ramakrishna and his householder disciples. Right? In this book, God Lived With Them, what kind of spiritual instruction Sri Ramakrishna had given to his monastic disciples, future monastic disciples. You would see these teachings here. Master Mahasaya did not mention about some of these things because he was not knowing, because he was not there. Sri Ramakrishna sometimes, you know, after the householder disciples would go away, he would bolt his room from within, and then he would ask these people to stay back, and then he would give them the instruction. What it would take to realize God. Because he wanted to have some people who can devote completely for God, who would give up their lives for searching the truth. In fact, according to him, that is the only purpose of life, only objective of life. We all miss that. Our education systems are structured in such a way. Nobody tells us that. Seek truth, seek truth. No relative, no father, no mother. And Sri Ramakrishna would tell these disciples that the worldly pleasures, the worldly joys are all vanity. There is no true joy, there is no true happiness possible here. We all have started on the premise that the world actually is created for our happiness. God has created the world for our pleasure. And that is the premise with which we started. We don't understand. Okay? God has not created this world to entertain, so much to entertain us as to entangle us. The world is a great source of entanglement. It is a temptation, it is a trap. So, but it will give us a real education if you know that actually. The creation has a creator. And this creation helps you to understand the genius of the creator all the time. And if you, every time when you look something grand in this world, of course everything is grand if you have that kind of eye to see. A small seed we put into the soil and it becomes a big tree. How? It becomes, that's all. The number of chemical processes that are involved there at a minute level, at a microscope level. It's beyond actually ken of human intellect to fathom, to understand it. Everything is a miracle in that way. But every such occasion, every such thing actually reminds you of the genius and ingenuity of the Creator. It doesn't take much time for you to become a mystic. You'll come close to God. So today our condition is that. We are so deeply involved in the creation that we have totally forgotten the Creator. Totally forgotten the Creator, that's why our lives have become so miserable. This way, now and then, these prophets, the incarnations of God, spiritually illumined souls, they come in our midst and remind us, no, this is a mistake. You should not forget the Creator. How you search the Creator, the choice is left to yourself. These pictures, the lives of these people will help us, will guide us. They serve as a beacon for us. Take whichever kind of guidance that you want. But take up some path and try to search for the Creator through the creation. Make your life blessed. We shall stop here for today. So on this auspicious occasion of Swami Premanandji Maharaj's birthday, let us all pray to this illumined sage that he might shower his blessings upon us and help us get enlightenment in this birth itself. 2 minutes, we shall pray before we disperse. Ooh. Ooh.